today, then we will be discussing the application of quantum field theory at low energies. So the idea is the following, that suppose you want to take into account the effect of quantum electrodynamics collections, but you have to see its effect on atomic physics, right? An electron moving inside an atom, okay, moving around the nucleus. So how do we use quantum field theory effects to take analyze those situations? And the reason for doing this, one of the reasons for doing this is that the low energy experiments actually provide the most stringent tests of quantum electrodynamics, okay, or quantum field theory in general. Because doing measurement at high energy is not easy. And typically the high energy experiments are good for discovering new particles, because you will not see the new particles by working at low energy. But because the atomic energy levels, for example, are understood so well, that even a small change in the energy level of the atom can be detected and compared with what we see in experiments. Okay, so that's the reason why you want to see how to study these experiments.
So PFT, using PFT, study low energy physics.
Example is a precision So the general strategy that one follows is to use what is called the effective action. Use effective action. Sometimes it's also called one particle irreducible, one PI effective action. Okay, I'll explain the origin of this name. So the idea here is the following, that we try to encode the effects of complicated quantum corrections, loop effects, into a modification of the classical action. Once we have taken the effect of loop corrections into the classical action, then we study it, okay, as if it's a classical theory. So for example, if we take quantum electrodynamics, we'll try to modify the action of the quantum electrodynamics, okay, by taking into account this effect of the loops. Okay. And then starting from that action, we can do what we normally do in quantum mechanics. For example, you can go to the first quantized approach, okay, derive the Dirac equation. Okay. The Dirac equation, of course, will have modifications because the action has changed. Okay. And then use that for atomic physics. Okay. So that's the general principle, and I'll try to illustrate how that works. Okay. And I'll do this in the context of QED.
So you'll use QED as illustration because this is where it has been applied most.
So let's start with diagrams of the following kind. Okay, a diagram with two external fermions, one external gauge field. So let me label the indices. So I'll call this alpha, beta. I'll take the momentum p to be this way. So this will be minus p, sorry, minus p minus k, and momentum k entering this way. This also will carry the index p. Now this, of course, we know is infinite. Okay, so this by itself will not make sense. So you have to add to this the counter from diagram. And then let's also consider adding to it the zeroth order diagram, okay, the original vortex, okay, which is of course this gamma. Okay, this we know is gamma. The momentum levels are identical. So if you take a sum of these three diagrams, we can write it in a general form as I gamma mu alpha beta, and it will be a function of P and K. Okay, I have not done anything. I have just said that let's suppose that the sum of these three amplitudes, we don't consider the external propagators, okay, that's this part. So this, for example, which is the lowest order contribution, that will give you gamma mu.
You are considering electric charge E also.
Electric charge, okay, so I can take the E outside or E inside, whatever you want to do. So let's say suppose we have E. Well, let's put everything inside gamma mu, capital gamma mu. Okay. So this contribution, this one, is just E R times gamma mu. And that's the leading zero total contribution. And then the one loop contribution will come from the sum of these two. Okay, and then there are higher loop contributions. Okay, but let's suppose the total thing we call I gamma mu alpha beta, some function, right? This function you can calculate by explicitly doing the group integrals. Now the idea is that the effect of all these corrections can be thought of is identical to the correction that you get from the from a tree amplitude. But re-amplitude calculated with a complicated action. Okay. So suppose we consider the following action. Consider a term in the action of this form. Okay. So if you take a term of this form, the tree amplitude calculated from this, tree amplitude calculated from, let me call this vortex. The tree amplitude calculated from this will reproduce exactly this. Right? It's not that you have not gained anything, right? Yeah, because after all, to calculate this gamma mu, we have to sum over all these diagrams. Right? This is just a way to encode the result that if we now write a term in the action after you have calculated gamma mu from there, if we write a term in the action of this kind, okay, then the tree amplitudes of this, from this will reproduce the sum of those. Is this clear? Okay. So this is a general idea that we calculate all these loop amplitudes, but then we try to write down some action, okay, which we call the effective action, whose tree amplitudes produce the sum of all possible Feynman diagrams. Okay, just like the tree amplitude computed from this vortex, okay, will take care of all of these graphs. Because gamma mu by definition is the sum of these contributions. Is this point clear? So what is the idea? The idea is that once we write down an effective action of this kind, then we can forget about all quantum loops. From that effective action, we can do what we normally would do in classical physics. for example, we can write down the analog of the Dirac equation. Okay, how will you write down the Dirac equation? We're varying the action with respect to psi bar. Right, we'll get an equation. Okay, that will be the analog of the Dirac equation, but that Dirac equation is already knowable on the quantum connections. Okay, so you can then use that Dirac equation, that modified Dirac equation, to study atomic physics problems. You have used Dirac equation for atomic physics, the normal Dirac equation. Right, in quantum mechanics too, you must have done it, right? You know this magnetic moment, electron magnetic moment, that there is a gyromagnetic ratio, G equal to 2, right? Okay. So just like you take the normal Dirac equation, right? Go to non-relativistic limit applied to atomic physics, you can take this modified Dirac equation with all of these. Right? This will of course also contain the normal one, because the Dirac equation in the background gauge field, if you want, there's a this has a gamma mu piece, right? Okay, that will give the standard interaction with the electromagnetic field, right? The gamma mu mu piece. But there will be additional terms. Anyway, we will discuss that later. Okay, how to do this. So, I will give some more examples. So, these graphs actually has names. Okay, since QED was one of the first serious quantum field theorists, all of these graphs have names, so I'll. Yeah. This is called a vortex collection. The second one is called self energy. Electron self energy graph. That's this. Okay, and then that have higher order terms. So again, let's label. This will be minus P, this will be alpha, beta, suppose this is given by I sigma alpha beta. Then the effect of corrections of this kind can be represented by writing it on the effective action. Let's call this S2, which is integral sigma alpha beta. Of course, I can write anything, because this is just numbers. These are the operators. So here I could have written the gamma mu in between the two sides. I have just chosen to write it this way. So is this clear? Right? That if I write it down in the action like this, then there will be two-point vortex that you calculate from this action. The two-point vortex will be like this.
So this sigma vortex contains only the fermion line also. Means
only the?
Means only the propagator fermion.
This part. Not the external ones. Okay. So in defining this.
No, I am telling that this is just the correction of the. They are also such kind of things, it means. Yeah, only the propagator of the fermion, direct propagator.
This one.
Yeah.
No, no, no. The whole diagram. I have to do a loop integral, right?
Yes.
This is integral d for l.
Then no, I am taking this is the correction. So original one plus correction.
Yeah, yeah. So original one I have not written yet.
Okay.
So there is a free term, right? Psi bar I gamma mu del mu minus m psi. That part I have not written here. Okay. This is the part that comes from this correction. Okay. All the interaction terms I am writing.
Sigma equals to sum of all.
sigma is equal to sum of all, but if you want to work to all one loop, see, this is the only contribution.
No, I mean, including that counter term and three loops.
Yes, oh, yeah, that is the written counter term. That's important. So before two loops, I have to write the counter term. Plus,
sigma is this
plus this. And then higher order terms, if you want to go to higher order. Okay, because without this, it is not even finite, right? Okay. In fact, here, I should have all written R. I'll always want to denormalize things. Okay, so that there is no, this effective action that I'm writing shouldn't have any divergence. Okay, so all of these, because these are all denormalized things. Okay, so similarly, here also I'll write denormalized. So now we can try to see what its interpretation is, but to give this give interpretation, we have to also add it to the leading term, the original term. That term in the action, of course, is still there. So total action, so total quadratic action in formula. Will be integral E4 T over 2 pi T 4 this, okay? Okay, so if you are trying to calculate the quadratic terms in the formula, okay, this is the action and then this is the cubic term that couples two formulas and gets fixed. Pardon? ER in the gamma mu, that means the part that I have erased. Yeah, so gamma mu part will be multiplied by ER, yes. Yeah, so I'm in the definition of capital gamma, right? I have not included ER, so the first root sum ER gamma mu plus higher order terms. I could have taken the ER factor outside, okay? It doesn't really. So this probably have encountered earlier. Okay, let me just say the vacuum, the next one. So this is self-energy. The final graph that I'll be considering is called vacuum polarization. Okay, I'll come back to this term. That is this graph. It's also called photon self-energy plus counter term plus higher order terms. So if we call this mu and nu, then this, suppose this is pi mu nu of p, okay, that's the evaluation of this diagram plus the counter term. Then this means that we have to add, sorry, I, See, I am always putting the I with sigma or pi, because from the axon when you go to the vortex, there's an I, okay? Because it's e to the I, yes. So that's why in the definition of sigma I have already included an I. That's why you don't have to worry about it. I, similarly, you had I pi, you know. So this will come from an axon of the following form.
E4t.
So this will add to the Maxwell action plus gauge fixing job and so on. Is this okay? Of course, this is not the end of it. Okay, there are many more terms. In the effective action contains infinite number of terms, because you can also have terms like this. Right? This will be two photon psi bar psi coupling. You have to add that also in the action. Okay, you can have terms like this. Four photon coupling. Okay, this also you have to add. But to any given order, for any given purpose, you can just stop somewhere. Okay, you don't really have to add all the infinite number of terms. But the idea is that the total contribution to the effective action, the total contribution can be encoded in the sum of diagrams like this. So that once you got the effective action, then you just calculate three level graphs, okay? And that's all that you have to do. Okay, because all the loop effects have already gone in, the definition of the vortices.
So finally, finally,
you
anyway have to do this calculation
exactly
using the original
action. That's right.
And then plug it in.
Here. Exactly. So you have to do those calculations anyway, right? So it's not that you are saving the calculation. The question is, how are you going to make use of them? Right? Because in low energy physics, you don't actually calculate scattering amplitude. Right? So there, starting from the effective action is helpful. Right? Because we'll see how we can make use of the effective action for studying the low energy physics. Is this clear? Now, one thing I should emphasize is that when you are calculating the vortex correction, okay, gamma mu, you don't include diagrams like this. Why not? Because this diagram that when you, once you have the self-energy correction, right, and the vortex correction, this will be one of the three level diagrams that is calculated from there. Right? This will be part of the self energy and this will be part of the vortex. Okay? So this is the reason why this kind of action is called one particle irreducible effective action. Okay? So the idea is that if the diagram is such that by cutting one internal line, it breaks apart into two parts, then you don't include those graphs. Okay? Because those graphs will be already obtained by three level graphs of the vortices. Okay, so this you will not include separately as a term in the vortex. So once you have the effective action, you can do many things with it. So let me just discuss a few things that you can do. So first, let's look at this term in the effective action. This is a full quadratic term in the sign. By definition, sigma contains all these corrections. Okay. So from this, we can read out the propagator, right? It's I times E stas minus M plus sigma inverse. If you want to do a perturbation expansion, you can do it. but that's not necessary and it's not also very useful. You see, sigma is already of order E square. It's in the coupling, it's already has two powers of coupling constant. So in partial motion theory, you can expand it out in principle. So the way you will expand it is you will write this as I times E slash minus N times 1 plus E slash minus M inverse sigma, this whole thing inverse. So this is I 1 plus E slash minus M inverse sigma inverse E slash minus M inverse. A times B inverse is B inverse is A inverse, right? That's what I'm using here. And then you can expand in partial motion expansion because sigma is small, right? So you just use the expansion of 1 plus x. So this becomes I times B slash minus A inverse. Then the first term, when you pick up the 1, then there will be minus I times B slash minus A inverse sigma E plus minus M inverse sigma plus M. And this you can easily recognize as actually the usual partial motion expansion of the propagator. So the first term is just this. The second term. Pardon? Oh, because when you expand this out, it's 1 minus P slash minus A inverse sigma. Oh, there is no sigma, thank you. The last one is first. The next term will have two factors of sigma. So the first term has the interpretation of this, the second term has the interpretation of this, 1 sigma inserted. Next term, which will have 2 sigmas, we have the interpretation of sigma and so on. Okay, so it's the usual partial motion expansion of the propagator that has been resummed to write in this form. Okay, but this form certainly is more useful than as a sum like this. So you have probably done a similar resummation for in one of the homework problems, right? For the scalar. So you actually had to calculate the mass renormalization. Right? So the mass renormalization, suppose you want to calculate the renormalized mass. Right? What is the renormalized mass? That's the place, the value of E squared where this has a pole. Okay. So renormalized mass, or the physical mass, not renormalized mass, physical mass. Is the value of minus P square, where P slash minus M plus sigma has zero eigenvalue. Okay, sigma. Okay, and typically you solve it perturbatively. Okay. To leading order, you know that from P square equal to minus M square, this has zero eigenvalue. You use that leading order value to calculate sigma. Right? Then you again work out where this has a zero eigenvalue and so on. Right? That's how you proceed. And that's for the scalar case, that's how you solve presumably. Right? If you started with P square equal to minus MR square and then you started correcting. But let's see what this means, where this has zero eigenvalue. This has zero eigenvalue means that where P slash minus M plus sigma P on psi tilde P equal to zero has a solution. That solution is a zero eigenvalue. If this has a zero eigenvalue, that means this has a solution. But this having a solution, what is this equation? equation is exactly what you will get as the equation of motion derived from here. If you think of this action, right, to linearize order, if you forget about the correct interactions, then the equation of motion for psi bar is p slash minus m plus sigma of p on psi tilde is equal to 0. So you see that the effective action has this interpretation that the solution to the classical equations of motion, of the linearized equations that we derive from the effective action, give rise to the normalized masses. Okay? So once you have gotten the effective action, you can calculate the masses, okay, as if it's just a classical action and you are trying to solve the equations of motion. Okay? Linearized equations of motion. So that's the utility. That having this notion of effective action means that once you have got the effective action, then it's as if you are solving classical problems with that effective action. Just classical equation. But of course, it's highly quantum, right? Because sigma of p contains all the information, right, that we need. But now let's ask a somewhat different question. Okay. You're not interested in finding the mass, okay, that say we already know. We want to know how the motion of an electron in background electromagnetic field gets affected. Or how the Dirac equation in background electromagnetic field get affected by quantum corrections. Okay, once you know the Dirac equation, you can work out what the effect is on atoms, for example, right? Because starting from Dirac equation, you know how to derive atomic physics results, right? Because Dirac equation, after all, in the non-relativistic limit, becomes Schrodinger equation, right? With some corrections which are responsible for various atomic physics corrections. You did hydrogen atom using Dirac equation, fine structure, right? Energy level split because of the corrections that come from Dirac equation. Right? You start from Dirac equation and go to non-relativistic limit. Right? What you are saying here is that you don't start from a Dirac equation in background electromagnetic field, but Dirac equation, the modified Dirac equation that you get from this new effective action. Okay, and do exactly what you had done earlier for the hydrogen atom. Okay, but you don't use the usual Dirac equation in background electromagnetic field, you use this modified Dirac. So let's see what the modified Dirac equation will be. So, the exercise, if you take delta S, delta psi bar tilde alpha minus p equal to 0. Okay, this of course you can easily read out what it is. Then the equation is p slash minus m plus sigma p alpha beta. Plus plus their corrections, plus order
tilde square, or higher powers of psi, okay, which is ignored. Okay, we want to study the motion of an electron. It's a weak background. So ignore these. Ignore. Because we want to study weak background.
If you want to include strong field, then you have to include all also connections of this guy.
Cyber alpha?
Yeah.
Cyber alpha.
Well, I varied with respect to cyber alpha. That's why it got stripped off. And whenever I'm writing these are all renormalized fields. Okay, I will not write afterward, but let me write once. These are all renormalized fields. That time. Pardon?
A?
No. This is, yeah, this is the normalized mass, of course. Okay. The physical mass is the pole of this. Because in this, right, once you have split into counter terms, right, this part is normalized. This should have been the normalized mass, right? Because the part of this, part of the mass, right, the difference between M and MR has gone into this counter term, the cancel of the divergence. A is small. The background electromagnetic field that we'll be considering will be small. Pardon?
Coupling constant G is small.
Yeah, coupling constant G is small, of course, you are doing an expansion in the coupling constant. Right? But even if the coupling constant is small, you can imagine that we put electron in a very, very strong background field, right? In which case the higher order connections in A may be important. A mu, mu couplings. Right? Because here, if you are trying to think of the motion of the electron in a background field, right, there are many different parameters. Right? The coupling constant is one parameter, but the strength of the background electromagnetic field is an independent parameter. Right? I could imagine that is very strong, so that
it's weak in the sense of F mu strength.
Exactly. Okay? A mu, of course, because of the gauge symmetry, right, adding some constant to mu is not going to make any difference, right? That will be inbuilt in the theory. Ultimately, all equations of motion should depend through mu. Okay. Is this clear? So this is the momentum space. You can of course Fourier transform and go to the position space basis, right? And you can easily check that if sigma is 0 and gamma mu is gamma mu, is ER gamma mu, then you get back the usual Dirac equation, I gamma mu del mu by the same psi plus gamma mu in mu psi. Okay, this sign often depends on a convention, whether it's plus here or minus here. I have used this convention of plus here. Okay, it's not very hard to see that this, after all, if you remove this, then the Fourier transform of this is I gamma mu del mu minus m. Right? And the this capital gamma mu becomes ER times small gamma mu. So the Fourier transform of this becomes this mu times I. Okay, but this is the more general equation, right? So the idea is that you want to see what kind of correction gamma mu receives, okay, and use that to study how the interaction of the electromagnetic field gets modified, right? And that's the QED effect, right? Gamma mu will get contribution from one loop, but after you have calculated the one loop contribution from gamma mu, we can just use this kind of classical analysis to determine what its effect will be on the motion of the electron. Is this principle clear? Right? So there is one part which is calculation of gamma mu, where you have to use the loops, right? But then, in order to interpret what it means, okay, it's best to think in this classical terms. Okay? That look at it as a collection of the effective action and then think of this as a classical equation. So the idea is that we will now interpret, we'll reinterpret this as the modified Dirac equation in a background electromagnetic field. Okay, whereas this was in the original Dirac equation in background electromagnetic field. So the calculation of gamma mu, I'll not describe briefly, I'll not do the full analysis. Okay, but just say a few words about how it's done. So let me start by writing down the expression for gamma mu. So this is a one loop contribution. There is a ER gamma mu, which is the three level, which I'm not using. Yeah. So let me draw the momentum again. Comes in from here. Okay, we use Feynman gauge. This is L, so this is P minus L. This will be P minus L plus K, and this is P plus K. You are minus P minus K if you think of it this way. If you think of all momentum as entering, that's how you have been leveling. For the minus to minus k entering. So up to numerical factors, okay, which I'll not write down. So this involves combinatoric factors, one about 3 factorial because it is third order in quarter version theory and so on. Up to numerical factors is d4 in about 2.24. Minus I over L square. Okay. So let me label the indices here also. This is rho. I'll also call this rho because I'm using Feynman gauge. So there is a eta mu rho, right? And this propagator. So both indices are the same. So clearly, if this is rho, then this will also be rho. So this is this propagator. So I have to now write the propagator for all of these and the vortices. So if you remember, it goes opposite to the arrow, right? The matrix product goes opposite to the arrow. So I start from this end. So that's I gamma rho. Then we have I times this propagator. So this is P minus L plus K. So P plus minus L plus K plus M. Over P minus L plus Q square plus M square. I think that's a minus. Right? It's I over P slash minus M, but when you multiply numerator and denominator by P slash plus M to bring it into this form, it becomes I over minus P square minus M square times the numerator. Okay, that's the propagator. This is familiar to everybody. Okay? This is a standard formula propagator. Okay, so then comes the gamma mu, I gamma mu. Then this one. All the I epsilon I am not writing because eventually we will go to Euclidean momentum anyway. And then here there is a I gamma rho. Okay, I'll just avoid writing gamma rho, gamma mu, or gamma rho, gamma sigma, and writing eta rho sigma. Right?
Yeah, so just write the rho, rho, sigma.
Yes, I mean, because it's Feynman propagator and these are the same, right? Otherwise I should have written gamma rho, gamma sigma and eta rho sigma, right? And then that could have been also L rho L sigma, it's a general alpha range. Times numerical factors, which I'm not writing. Okay. So the idea is to first evaluate this, and then by substituting this here, we can start see its effect. Okay, what effect does this term have on the motion of the electron in background electromagnetic field? Now you see here that this equation, of course, has two effects of quantum mechanics. There is a sigma, which is self energy, and then there is gamma. In any general problem, if you are actually studying the motion of an electron inside an atom, you have to take into account all of these. Okay, but we want to look at just some specific effect. Okay, which is that how does the coupling to the of the electron to a background electromagnetic field change due to quantum mechanics? So for that, we just focus on this term, right? We forget about the sigma. Okay, so lowest order, we just said sigma equal to 0, and we focus on this term. Okay, but this is only because we want to ask the specific question of looking at how the electron couples to background electromagnetic field, how that coupling gets modified. Okay? In any general problem, right, you have to include everything. Right? You have to include these graphs, you have to include the effect of the fact that the photons themselves, their propagator gets changed. Right? Tomorrow we'll see one effect of changing the photon propagator. Okay, but today we'll just focus on this particular problem. Okay, so this of course can in principle be calculated. Okay, it's a complicated integral. Okay, it can be calculated numerically, but to get some analytic handle, okay, we have to make approximation. Okay, before I talk about the approximations, let me just give the general strategy of how one goes about doing the calculation. Okay, at least the initial setup, you don't have to make any approximations. Okay. So the first thing to notice is that we have three denominators, right? So what do you do here? You have to use the Feynman parameterization to combine the denominators, right? So you write 1 over ABC as integral 0 to 1. D alpha 1, 0 to 1, D alpha 2, 0 to 1, D alpha 3, and then I think it's 2 over D alpha 1 plus D alpha 2, plus C alpha 3, okay, CQ. And then there's a delta function, right? 1 minus alpha 1 plus alpha 2. So it's really two integrals, that. So once you do that, then you see that in the numerator, so you have alpha 1 L square, alpha 2 times this, plus alpha 3 times this. So the L square coefficient, so the numerator, the L square coefficient will be alpha 1 plus alpha 2 plus alpha 3. Right, because you get alpha 1 L square from here, alpha 2 L square from here, and alpha 3 L square from here. The denominator, this is sum of the two, three, and this is equal to 1 because of this delta function. Then you will have L dot something, right, that you can calculate. This something is a complicated function of the alphas, these case, plus something, whole cube. So then what we will do is that you will, this is the one, so you will try and complete the square, you will write this as L plus something
square plus something Q. Is this procedure clear? Right? This is quadratic, you complete the square, L plus some vector square, and then whatever is left, you call,
yes.
You keep it here. Then you call this LP. And change variable from D4L to D4L. This is the only integration variable, right? So this is just a shift. So there is no Jacobian in this process. Now let's look at the numerator. Numerator has to be simplified using gamma matrix algebra. Okay, there is a gamma rho, right? Contractions, there are various identities involved in the gamma matrices, right? So that you have to use to simplify the numerator. Okay. But if you just look at the power of L, right, how many powers of L are there in the numerator? Okay. One L from here, one L from there. Okay. Two powers of L. Okay. So the numerator had two L's, L rho, L sigma. Then there are linear order and then log n. L rho times something plus the something. This you re express in terms of L tilde, right? So you will get L tilde rho, L tilde sigma plus something times L tilde rho plus something. You can always change variables, right? From L to L tilde by this. These should vanish. These should vanish because L tilde goes to minus L tilde symmetry will kill it, right? Because now the numerator is even under L tilde goes to minus L tilde. So linear terms are gone. Right? But you still have quadratic term and L independent term. So now you can integrate. Right? You integrate by the same, by the standard set of formula that we wrote down. Right? But you have to use dimensional regularization. Is it clear why?
Six powers.
Yeah, six powers here. Four integration and two. Right. So it's logarithmic divergence. You have two dimensional regularization, which is not surprising. This is supposed to be divergent, right? This normalizes the gamma mu. So you do that. You do dimensional regularization. Extract out the infinite part. Right. Cancel it by using the counter term, and you get a finite quantity. So that finite quantity is still expressed in terms of two integrals, alpha 1 and alpha 2. Okay, alpha 3 is of course 1 minus alpha 1 minus alpha 2. Okay. You still have to do the alpha integrals. Okay. So while doing the alpha integrals, you make some approximation. Okay, because otherwise it's difficult to do the alpha integrals exactly. Okay, but till you reach that stage, you don't really need any approximation, right? You can do this explicitly. Okay, the algebra is more complicated, but there's no in principle difficulty in carrying out this. So now the approximation.
Contains
yes. No, alpha doesn't contain, but this thing contains dependence on p and k and everything, right? Alpha of course are independent integration variables.
Yeah, alpha.
Yeah, but these things certainly contain dependence on p and p's and the k's and so on. Okay, so that's why the alpha integral in general is complicated because it's a complicated integrant, right? Involving all these.
In principle, you can just put it on a computer and evaluate, right? For any given external P and K, right? It's a two-dimensional integral after all, right? You can just easily do it on a computer, but let's see how far you can go analytically using approximations. So I have already talked about weak field approximation. Okay. So now we also use slowly varying. So slowly varying field means you can try to expand in powers of k. Okay? Because k is the momentum carried by the photon, right? Slowly varying electromagnetic field means k is small. Okay, we try to do a Taylor series expansion in k. We expand in powers of k. Eventually, we will try to apply it to constant magnetic field. Okay. Constant magnetic field means that the first derivative of A is non-zero, okay, but the second derivative onwards is zero. Okay. That's constant magnetic field. Okay. So this means that if you expand in powers of K and just get up to the first order in K result, that is good enough, right? Because constant magnetic field will be the first order in K. Okay. Second derivative of A is zero. So expanding powers of K. That's the first approximation. Second, you can make your life simplify. You can simplify your life by using the following fact. Then you see, you are trying to get a solution to this equation, right? E slash minus m psi, that your equation that you are eventually looking at is E slash minus m psi plus something. Plus something equal to 0. This something is already small because your background field is weak. Okay. So to leading order, the solution is just that of P plus minus M psi equal to 0. Okay. Because this is small, to leading order solution, right, is just that of P plus minus M psi equal to 0. These are all MR. But that, of course, you know what it is, right? It's some U. Right? The U and V, I mean, you are considering electron here, so forget about the V. The U satisfies P plus minus M on U equal to 0, right? So, leading order, you can think of psi as U. So, the way we utilize it is the fact that you have this gamma mu alpha beta, right? Actually, equation involves gamma mu alpha beta P plus K. Acting on psi is a beta of t. Okay, this is the full equation. Okay, this is the term, the combination that appeared there. Okay. So the idea is that you simplify this by pretending as if this is u. Okay, because this already has one part of a mu built in. Right. So while analyzing this, you can pretend as if this is u. Okay, because the difference between this and u is of order a. Right? If a was not there, this would have been u. Okay? So by pretending that this is u, you are making an error, but that error is second order. Okay? So you don't.
Sir, means in psi there is u and v, and means if you consider only u part, then that is basically means you are considering that kind of non-relativistic approximation. Means because v is kind of v by c power of u, means v by c of u, right?
Well. Right now, we don't think or have to think in terms of non-relativistic approximation. Eventually, we will go there. Right? All I am saying is that the equation is P plus minus M psi equal to 0.
Yeah.
Right? So, you assume that psi, so you have to pick some solution for psi, right, about which you are doing the approximation. Imagine that the psi you have picked u. Right? Then the departure from u, of course, actually the full solution is not u. Right? It will change because we have this. But the departure from u is of order a, right? Of the order of the background field strength. So because this already has a power of background field strength, there is an a mu also here, right? Somewhere a tilde mu of k. So because it already has a power of a tilde mu, right? Here we can simplify things assuming that this is u. Okay? So the way it helps is that because if you assume that this is U, right, it satisfies P slash minus M on that equal to 0, right? So many of the Gamma matrix algebra become simplified because whenever there is a P slash acting on the on this, you just replace it by M. Okay, that's the kind of simplification you achieve by doing this. Right? So the numerator factors become simpler. Right? Because whenever there is a P slash, you replace it by M. This equation? This one? Oh, this is a big equation that I wrote down. That when you vary with psi tilde, right? There is a P slash minus M minus sigma P. M or minus sigma P. Psi, but sigma P we are ignoring, right? To first order, we just replace it by MR. So P slash minus MR. And then this term is what I have written. So the idea is that you have, I mean, so far what I have described is just gamma mu alpha beta calculus, right? Without worrying about what it's contracting with, right? Now I am saying that you can pretend as if this gamma mu alpha beta is acting on a U, okay? Because approximately what it will act on is U, right? And that just makes life a little simpler because you can use P slash on U equal to 0, P slash minus M on U equal to 0. So what I'll do now is to write the final answer that one gets. And if you want to see, not if you want to see, you should see the details of this calculus. First, you should try to do the details yourself. Right? It's not very hard because it's just all the integrals are there. Right? You have to just try to do the integrals and take this q small. That's important. Right? The k, take k small and expand out. Right? That makes life simple. And then try to evaluate it as much as you can. Okay? But the full details you can find in this book by Peskin and Schroeder. Is an introduction to QFT. And I think that this vortex collection they do in section 6.3. Okay, so you can try to work out, as I said, as much as you can yourself and then compare with what the calculation that they have given. But here is the final result that one gets for gamma mu. Okay, with this approximation. So gamma mu turns out to be ER times gamma mu. And then there is a alpha is ER square. Alpha is ER square. Okay, which is what we normally call the fine structure constant. This is the leading term. Okay. This is the first correction. We are expanding the power of k. This is the first correction. And then the most important term that, at least for us, is a term like this, gamma mu nu. So C1, C2 are calculable constants. So let me write the well, C2 is calculable, C1 is ambiguous. Can you see why is it ambiguous? Yes? Yeah. C1 is can be absorbed by changing the finite part of the denormalization, right? Because you get ER gamma mu as the original coupling, right? You multiply it by Z. And you try to determine Z, but Z can be only determined up to a finite term shift, right? So that finite shift is this C1. Okay? So you can in principle set C1 equal to 0. Okay? even if you don't set C all equal to 0, the important point is that this combination, okay, you choose your normalization scheme, but this combination is what determines the coupling of the electromagnetic field, the lowest order result in the leading order, the coupling of the electromagnetic field to the fermion is determined by this combination, E r times 1 plus C 1 alpha. So that's what appears in this effective action, right? You never calculate individually E r and C 1. Or not calculate, you never measure individually E r and C 1. Right? Because it's this combination that appears in the coupling. This is what we normally call the physical coupling. Okay? Physical electric charge or physical E p. So E p, which E stands for physical, is E r times 1 plus C 1. Okay, so in this case, one convenient denormalization scheme is to just set C1 equal to 0. Okay, then ER is equal to E. Okay, but it's not necessary. You can keep ER and EP different, but this is the physical one. Okay. And to this order, ER you can replace by EP. Okay, because the difference between ER and EP is higher order. Okay, so this you can think about EP square, EP cube. So we write gamma mu as EP gamma mu plus C2 EP cube gamma mu. So gamma mu AP is a mu. This is the combination that appears in the coupling, right? Gamma mu AP is a mu is EP gamma mu AP is a mu plus C2 EQ Q. Oh, gamma mu nu, is this clear what gamma mu nu is? This is a commutator, anti-symmetric combination of gamma mu and gamma mu. C2 EPQ gamma mu nu K mu EPQ. So this one is of course the conventional coupling, right? The standard coupling of electromagnetic field to the photon. This combination, can you recognize what this combination is? First of all, this is F mu, or the Fourier transform of F mu. Is that clear? Because any, this is carrying momentum K, right? K nu A tilde mu, right? It's already anti-symmetric because in mu nu. So this is a Fourier transform of the F mu. Is that clear? So using this, we can actually rewrite the equation. So I had written in the momentum space, but now I can write down the position space equation of motion for this. In position space, you get I gamma mu L mu psi plus EP gamma mu psi plus some constant. Okay, there will be some factors in between. Okay, I'll not be very careful about that. CPQ times gamma mu nu F mu nu psi. Okay. Now let's consider the case of constant magnetic field. So constant magnetic field means the A0 is 0, right? Or okay, let me say in terms of Fi, F mu, no? So constant magnetic field, we have F 0 I equal to 0, and F I j is epsilon I j k d k. This is a magnetic field. Okay, epsilon I j k is the reciprocally anisometric Landé tensor. So then this becomes gamma ij, epsilon ij k, gamma ij k. Okay, again, I'm not writing what series, but this is something calculated from first principle, right? By doing a loop integral. Okay, by doing the loop integral and taking the k goes to the zero limit, you can explicitly calculate this coefficient C2. And this coefficient C2 basically determines what the coefficient C is. It is the same term written in position space. Okay, so now let's see how to interpret this. Okay, so in the Dirac equation you have got a new term. Okay, coupling to background magnetic field. But, so now, we'll take a non-relativistic limit. Slowly varying, slowly moving particles. So the idea is that we will try to identify the Hamiltonian. What term it adds to the Hamiltonian, right? Because once you identify what term it adds to the Hamiltonian, then the interpretation becomes simpler, right? It's a new contribution to the energy, right? Proportional to the magnetic field. Right? You can see what kind of contribution you are getting to the energy, right? Proportional to the magnetic field. So you have to identify what the Hamiltonian is. Right? So for this, you have to write the Dirac equation in a more familiar form. Right? I delta psi equal to h psi. Right? That's the standard form for the equations. Right? So to write it in that form, all you have to do is that you write this I gamma 0 del 0 psi. So you write it as I gamma 0 del 0 psi. Equal to something, right? You take everything else on the other side. Okay? And then multiply the left hand side by gamma 0 to remove the gamma 0 from here. Okay? Then apply gamma 0 on both sides. Add gamma 0 on both sides. So this gives you I delta psi equal to something. This something you interpret as an h times psi. This is what defines h. Yeah, this is the Dirac Hamiltonian. Right? In the Dirac Hamiltonian equation in the covariant form, right, is written here. Right? But in the form in which it's easier to interpret the various terms, right? For example, if you had when you took the non-relativistic limit, right, you must have brought it into this form and taken the non-relativistic limit, right? Because this is the way. This can make direct contact to the Schrodinger equation, right? I delta psi equal to h psi. So that h you will compare with what you have gotten in the Schrodinger problem. So once you do this, you can already see what its effect will be. The new term in h nu, will be proportional to c dpq gamma ij f is epsilon ijk dk psi, and then there is some gamma 0 acting on it. Okay, and then a minus sign. Okay, I just took everything on the other side, right, and multiplied by gamma 0. And psi, yes. But psi will not be there. Yes, thank you. Now we can take the usual non-relativistic limit and see what this term means in the non-relativistic limit, right? In non-relativistic limit, if you remember that four component psi becomes a two component scalar, right? Effectively, two of the components become irrelevant, right? It becomes a two component scalar. And these various matrices, Gamma matrices, right, decomposes into those two component matrices. So, this I'll leave as an exercise. This we should be able to check by a standard non-relativistic limit that you take. That this becomes a term proportional to sigma dot e. Okay, where sigma are the Pauli matrices. Is this clear? And now it's clear what the interpretation of this new term is. What kind of term is this? If you have a constant magnetic field and if you find that a Hamiltonian has got a term like B dot sigma. Sigma is a spin, right? In the non-relativistic limit, sigma is a spin. So this is a magnetic moment. Right? So effectively what you are seeing is that the quantum electrodynamic collections adds a magnetic moment to the electron. Right? When you try to study the motion of the electron in constant magnetic field, there is an additional contribution to the energy that is proportional to B dot S, the B dot the spin of the electron. Is this clear? So what this does is it effectively corrects the G factor of the electron. Right? The electron magnetic moment was G times the Bohr magneton, right? G was 2 for the electron, right? It's the intrinsic spin of the electron contributes to the magnetic moment by with a factor of 2 compared to the orbital angular momentum, right? That's the meaning of G. This will correct G. Right? The fact that there is an additional coupling, additional contribution to the magnetic moment, means that the effective G is corrected. Right? So this can be reinterpreted. As correction to G. Is this clear? So I'll now write down the final answer that one gets, okay, which is very explicit. So to one loop, one finds that G is 2 times 1 plus alpha over 2 pi. So what is alpha? Alpha is dt square, which is 1 over 137 point various things. So the important point is that this factor, 1 over 2 pi, is calculable from first principle. Right? It goes back to the diagram that we started with. Right? Evaluating the diagram and taking appropriate limit, so you can explicitly calculate this 1 over 2 pi factor. On the other hand, correction to the magnetic moment is measurable. Right? Because this will show up in the motion of the electron inside an atom, right? Because the nuclear magnetic moment, for example, will interact with the electron spin. Right? And will cause small shifts in the energy levels of the electron, okay. And those shifts will be sensitive to this. So as long as you can figure out the other origins of those small shifts, right? Of course, the energy level shift because of many reasons, right? This is only one of the effects. As long as you can figure out the other origin of those small shifts, you can actually experimentally test this.
The other origins are also correction to the in the power of alpha also, means.
Yes, they are also correction in powers of alpha, right? Some are nuclear effects, some are self-energy effects, for example. Right? There will be some effect we will see because of the vacuum polarization. That the photon, so tomorrow we will consider the effect of the vacuum polarization, the photon self-energy. Right? And we will see how that affects the energy levels. Okay? But this quantity can be measured even outside the atom. Right? Because this is really the motion of, even if you study the motion of a free electron in a magnetic field, right? Where those other effects are not there. You can see this. So this anomalous magnetic moment of the electron is a very accurately measured quantity. Okay, and this in fact has provided one of the most stringent tests of electrodynamics. Okay, I think the latest up to 4 loops on the one has calculated this correction, and it agrees with experiment. Okay, what you can measure in experiment, and any deviation from the prediction of QED, right, essentially indicates that you are missing some contribution, right? I think it's very hard to reconcile with QED not being correct, right? So, but typically what happens is that when you go to sufficiently high order, right, there are other loop effects, right? Not just QED loops, right? But electron can produce photons which can produce as a pair of hadrons, right, in the loop. Okay, at sufficiently high order, everything starts propagating. So those corrections are not always well understood, right? If there are some new kinds of particles, right, they will start propagating in the loop and contributing, right? So any deviation from the value that is predicted from QED, okay, after taking into other corrections, typically indicate that you have something more than what you have included in your theory. Okay? So this is, as I said, one of the most stringent tests of quantum electrodynamics, and also in general the techniques of quantum field theory. So I think I'll stop here. Next time we'll be studying again within atomic physics the effect of this diagram. Okay, this is also a loop diagram. Okay, we'll take this contribution and reinterpret this as a correction to the effective action. Okay, and see what kind of effect it produces to in atomic physics.